I think belief in the film is a critical factor, certainly for the actors, but also for everyone who's at a creative level. There's something also about guerrilla filmmaking where people just love the energy of it, and they love to have a film that they do believe in, that they can throw themselves into.
I always thought that Terminator 1, it's a wonderful life with guns.
Meeting Jim, seeing his artwork, seeing the endoskeleton, reading the script, slam dunk, not a question, this was going to be a memorable movie.
This is going to be a great movie if this is the script. We got to get this movie.
Everyone else around me said, maybe you should not play a villain. That is not good for your career.
I think the love story is what really made it work for the audiences.
We did everything you can imagine in terms of guerrilla filmmaking to pull the movie off.
Nights, rats, alleys, fast-moving cars.
So I set off the rest of the charges. We put it out, and there was a collective groan amongst everybody on the set.
I felt a sense of fear as to, can I do this? Can I cut a picture? It's this complex.
It's the feeling of Terminator. Gotta keep going, he's after us. The schedule is after us, you know, the deadline is after us.
Jim and I met in the early 73, I think, and there weren't that many people in the town who were interested in, you know, science fiction and all that kind of stuff. And there was a third friend of ours, and we're all still friends, a guy named Randy Frakes, and Randy's worked with Jim as well over the years. And, you know, I learned a lot about writing from Randy. I think Jim did too. And we met in this tiny little town, and we all wanted to be, you know, in the show business, you know, we all wanted to make movies. And he had met Gail Hurd on one of the Corman pictures. She was sort of a budding young producer at the time.
It started when I first met Jim, when he was working as a model builder on Battle Beyond the Stars, and I was the assistant production manager. I, of course, assumed he was the head of the model shop. It turned out he was just a model builder, but he acted like he was the head of the model shop. He had that kind of authority.
We were all doing work. I was doing post-production work in Venice. In on Main Street, and I know there was a model shop in the same building.
We came through the Roger Corman school together. We worked on Battle Beyond the Stars together. We knew each other pretty well.
Making Battle Beyond the Stars, we needed someone to step in as art director. And overnight, Jim went from model builder to art director.
You're at a point in your life where it's just all or nothing. You just go for it.
So as things progressed, it just seemed quite natural. We knew each other. That we would help each other write things and work on projects and that sort of thing.
We worked really closely together and decided that in the future we wanted to collaborate. He'd direct and I would produce.
It's really funny. Jim has said over the years that he always loved nightmares because they gave him great imagery, and like pleasant, happy dreams were just sort of a waste of time, you know.
When he was in post-production in Rome on Piranha 2, he called me one morning and said, in a fever dream, he had this vision.
I had this kind of recurrent image of this machine figure.
He said that he'd had this dream about the Terminator coming out of the fire.
And I began doing some drawings of it, and I saw that it was a robot design that could be split in half and still pursue its victims in classic sort of 70s slasher style. I thought, you know, a knife-wielding robot cut in half, crawling over the ground after some, you know, poor female victim, and that was sort of the nucleus for the story. Well, I came back from doing Piranha 2, from which I got fired, I think, not once, but twice.
And he came back, and he didn't have a nickel in his pocket.
My car had been repossessed, I was totally out of cash, and I wound up sleeping on the floor of Randy Frake's house. And during that time, I was sort of cooking this story.
And that's where the whole thing came from. They thought, yeah, well, a thing like that doesn't exist today, so it has to come from the future. And I remember very specifically, he wanted to make the hero of the piece a woman.
Well, I think I was probably influenced by Alien, which was one of the first science fiction films that really had a female protagonist who was a warrior in and of her own right. And I liked that idea, it appealed to me. It also sort of fit with my view of the female half of the species in general.
And what he was looking to do was to write something that would be so irresistible that no one would not let him direct it.
I just wrote a treatment longhand, maybe 40 pages, something like that. Now I had a treatment, this was a film that I wanted to make. I needed a producer. I needed a producer that I could trust to protect it and to protect me in the mix. I knew Gail. It was the type of material that she knew and that she understood, and she knew low-budget effects. So she was a natural choice.
We decided that we would collaborate on the film and bring it to the screen. We were turned down by every major studio. However, we did have one connection to Orion Pictures, Barbara Boyle and Francis Dole, who had worked for Roger Corman at New World Pictures, were both employed by Mike Medavoy. And we slipped the script to them, and they loved it. Jim Cameron had worked with Lance Henriksen on Piranha 2, and he very much wanted Lance to play the Terminator. He saw the Terminator initially as someone who would really blend in.
The Terminator I always saw as this kind of cipher, this kind of anonymous guy. And Lance had the suitable acting chops to be able to do a really interesting characterization.
That would have been really interesting because Lance saw the Terminator as a kind of a praying mantis, and he had kind of worked on these moves and this whole attitude. He put foil in his teeth and went around climbing up fire escapes in Venice and probably scared a lot of his neighbors.
I actually did a painting of Lance in the character, you know, with the leather jacket and the gun and the kind of the one red eye and the whole thing.
And I remember Lance actually came in full makeup to meet with John Daly at one point.
Lance showed up early. And so you have to imagine there's this waiting room and this very nice young female secretary, and Lance walks in as the Terminator. And he just kept sitting there, not moving the entire time or doing, you know, some bizarre behaviors, spooky stuff. And he had everybody in that office scared to death. They had no clue who this guy was, because Jim was going to show up. Jim had the meeting, and he was just bringing Lance along and saying, you know, look at this. This is a great guy. I worked with him on another movie. So he just kind of showed up, and they weren't expecting him, and they certainly weren't expecting him with metal teeth and in character. And I think they were about 10 seconds away from calling the police when Jim walked through the door and, you know, and said, oh, Lance. Everybody kind of calmed down. But he put the fear of God into those people, which is always a good thing to do to executives, don't you think?
Clearly, when we went with someone like Arnold Schwarzenegger, that was very different. And we had Lance in the film, and instead he played a police detective as opposed to the Terminator.
I hate these press cases, especially the weird press cases.
And believe it or not, O.J. Simpson was at one point brought up to star as the Terminator.
Basically, they were looking for someone to play the heroic character in the film, in the first Terminator. And they asked me to play that character. And I asked them to send me the script, that I have a slot open for spring, and I want to see the script first. And I read the script, and I immediately could relate much more to the character of Terminator than the heroic character.
Mike Medavoy called up and said I had to talk to Arnold to play Reese. And I thought, okay, that's fine. That's a lame idea, frankly, but I'll talk to him because, you know, you have to be very political, especially when you're starting out. You're on very, very thin ice. You can crash through at a moment's notice.
So he was a thing to be dealt with. Jim couldn't just say no. So the only way he could get out of it was to pick a fight with him. So I remember, you know, sort of in the house, and Jim says, well, wish me luck. I'm going to go meet Arnold. I'm going to have to pick a fight with Arnold because the only way I could get him out of the movie was to not get along with him, and then, you know, nobody would want to have them all work together. So he said, I'm going to go pick a fight with Arnold. If it doesn't go well, you can have the chair and the stereo, you know.
I went to meet with Arnold, found him to be charming, and the entire time that I was talking to him during that lunch, I was thinking, you'd make a great Terminator. He had such a strength of presence that I knew it would translate to the screen.
And as it turns out, Arnold didn't want to play Reese at all. Arnold read the script and said, well, I want to play this Terminator guy. And so Jim went from just about ready to pick a fight with him to, that's a good idea.
So I came back to John Daly and said, look, it's not going to work as Reese, but I think he'd make a great Terminator. John, to his credit, said, let's give it a try. Picked up the phone, called his agent. And I only heard, you know, my side of the or John's side of the conversation. And all I remember him saying is, yes, Lou, well, that's right. But he is the title character, Lou. After all, he's the title character. And, you know, what can you say? I mean, I know that Lou Pitt's side of the conversation was, he's only got six lines. He's only in a few scenes. But, you know, to his credit, Lou made the deal. And at that point, the floodgates opened. We were making a film.
In the way the Terminator was initially written, you know, 5'10", 6 feet tall, nondescript, and the whole idea was that he was supposed to be, invisible in plain sight. It can be argued that a 6'3", 220-pound, ripped Austrian guy is not your best under-the-radar infiltration unit, but you know what? It's Los Angeles.
It created the idea of this unstoppable Terminator, and you didn't need to believe initially that there was metal under that body. The body was enough to convince people that he was lethal. It really didn't hurt the credibility of the Terminator, which was great. We weren't sure at the beginning whether going in that direction would be successful, and as it turned out, it was really the right choice.
Arnold always struck me as having a larger sense of the movie. He signed on because he liked the movie, not necessarily just the character, and saw its potential. So we clicked right from the beginning.
Arnold was cast first. With Arnold, we essentially had a go picture. And then we could concentrate on filling the other parts with the best people for the roles and not necessarily star names. Michael Biehn, when he came to audition, had just finished playing St. Sebastian in a film, and he was much more internal and much less of the kind of action icon that you would expect for someone auditioning for the role of Reese, who is the action hero in the picture.
And I had just come from an audition of Cat on a Hot Tin Roof down at the Mark Taper. And it was a Jose Quintero production. And it was a big deal, so I'd worked real hard on the character and the accent and so on and so forth. And I went down there and I spent about, I don't know, 2 or 3 hours auditioning for Jose Quintero for Cat on a Hot Tin Roof and didn't get that role. But when I showed up for the Terminator audition and the Kyle audition, I guess I still had some of that Southern accent going.
It was not the audition that you would have thought we would respond to.
So I did the reading, I went back, and the feedback from my agent was that they liked me a lot. They thought I was right for the role, but they thought I was too regional. They didn't want to cast somebody that was Southern. And myself and my agents were like, well, what are you talking about? You know, I'm not Southern, I'm from Nebraska, you know, that's middle America, you know. See me again, that was, you know, I kind of realized what had happened. And so they saw me again.
I saw in Michael the kind of intensity and intelligence that I needed and the physicality.
There was something very vulnerable about him, and that was incredibly important, that he not only be an action star, but he have the vulnerability. And that's why we went with Michael, because he ultimately combined those two skills, the skill to be incredibly physical and believable in that part, as well as the emotional connection that he had with Sarah.
The thing that's interesting about that character is that all the exposition in the piece, who the Terminator was, where he came from, what happened in the past, what's going to happen in the future, who she was, who I was, who the Terminator was, I had to tell that story. Reese told the story from beginning to end about what's happening, because he's the only person who knew. Well, that's exposition, and that usually is a showstopper. That usually stops movies dead in their tracks. But what Jim did, and the brilliance, I think, of The Terminator, is that that story was told on the move. It was always told while car chases were going on, while we were running, while we were hiding. While we were being shot at, I was telling the story. You know, the Terminator's this, he's that, you know, and we're screeching around corners. So he mixed the action and the exposition, and it made it much easier for me to not become boring by, you know, sitting around telling the story.
When we met Linda, she also had the ability to transcend the genre and not be someone who simply screams really well, but someone who was believable as the girl next door who could ultimately become the mother who saves humanity. And that's not an easy transition.
With Linda, I saw the combination of the strength and the kind of the innocence that she needed, because she goes between two poles in that film. And you don't see the strength until the end.
She's a woman that grew and transformed on screen, and that's always a wonderful thing to get to play. You know, a challenge. And she's not someone that starts here and ends there. She went from a vulnerable, normal kind of a girl to someone who found all of her deep reservoirs of strength and came through, and that was good.
We had a great working relationship. We both worked extremely hard on it. I think it was more difficult for her because a lot of that stuff was very, very grueling, running and, you know, jumping and fighting, but she was game and she was good. I think Jim played off that a little bit. I think she got, you know, there were times that she got, you know, frustrated, tired, angry, and dirty, pissed off. And I think it absolutely worked for the character.
One of the other essential people that we were told we had to get in order for the film to be greenlit was someone who ultimately didn't work on the movie at all. We were told we had to get Dick Smith, who was the character makeup star at the time. And he was the one who agreed to talk with us, read the script, and then said, you know, I'm not the right guy for this. The right guy for this is Stan Winston. And he went to bat for Stan, as well as for the movie, to make sure that Stan was approved to come on board to head up the special effects.
And I was very haughty because I was the guy. And I saw this painting that he had done of the endoskeleton. I went, oh my God, this guy's awesome. And then I read the script. And suddenly I went from a guy who was sitting on a high horse to a guy who really wanted to work on this film.
Stan kind of signed on and did a lot of work early on, even when the film wasn't greenlit, and was a true believer.
With Fantasy 2, they also came on board early enough on that they could contribute tremendously to how we planned to bring each effect to the screen.
I read that script in like 45 minutes, and I think fast as I've ever read a script. It just went right through, and I put it down on Leslie's desk and said, this is great. This is going to be a great movie if this is this script. We got to get this movie.
I was called into the office of Gene Warren Jr. and Fantasy 2 Film Effects of Burbank to do the miniature pyrotechnics. And there on his desk were the storyboards and a lot of paintings of this new film called Terminator. And when I saw these things, I just flipped out because I thought to myself, well, this is as close as one of my favorite movies as I'm going to come, and that's The War of the Worlds.
Jim wanted to use those techniques of, you know, hanging wires on models, doing a lot of high-speed photography, in-camera effects particularly.
Gene Warren and those guys did effects the way I like to do effects. They like to build big models, blow stuff up, and work without a lot of motion control, and be kind of shoot from the hip, and have a painterly eye, and that sort of thing.
So basically, Fantasy 2 was doing the special visual effects. Stan Winston was doing the Terminator makeups, prosthetics, and so forth, heads, puppets.
They were able to use the storyboards to say, okay, we're going to do this live on the set. We're going to do this following frame through stop-motion animation. And that's part of the reason why the shots are so seamless, regardless of the technique that we used. Initially, we were supposed to film in the summer of 1983, and we were going to film in Toronto, Canada.
I spent a significant amount of time up there identifying locations, negotiating with city officials and so on about what roads we could have and, you know, what access we could have, what closures we could have, and, you know, chopping our way with a machete through that red tape.
Unfortunately, Dino De Laurentiis decided to preempt Arnold to star in the sequel to Conan the Barbarian.
And Dino wouldn't let you out to do
right.
Terminator first.
Well, because he read the script and he said to himself, wait a minute, they're trying to steal my star away.
Right.
And he knew it was a great script and he
right.
told me that.
And we had to shift our shooting schedule to spring, March 1984 in Los Angeles.
We wound up in a one-year holding pattern, during which I practically starved to death. You know, my mom was sending me coupons in the mail that allowed me to buy two Big Macs for the price of one so that I could survive, and then I'd get two and I'd have one day and one the next day. So, and using, you know, cost-saving techniques like this, which proved beneficial once we actually started making the film, I was able to survive long enough to begin production.
Arnold was so essential to making this film that everyone was willing and quite happy to put the film on hold until March. If it had been another cast person who wasn't as essential to the identity of the film, I don't think we would have waited.
So I kind of had about 8 months or 10 months knowing that I had the role, but not really being able to get started on it. Which for an actor is like,
It's good in one sense because you got plenty of time to work on it, but the other sense is like, well, do I really have it? I mean, who are these people? Jim Cameron, you know, I mean, is his word good?
The one nice thing about having a 9-month delay is that we had a soft prep for those 9 months. We were able to anticipate most of the production problems we encountered. Jim was able to storyboard almost the entire movie himself and created certain panels in color that he could pass out to the department head so they had a perfect idea of the visuals Jim planned to get on screen.
We knew we had to keep the costs down, but we were still being ambitious. So there was definitely a dialectic between myself as director, Gail as producer. It was really a team effort. We didn't always see eye to eye, but we always fought back to back.
On a day-to-day basis, I couldn't worry about how the movie was going to turn out. I had to make sure we got the shots we needed, that the compromises that we had to make during production weren't so great, that they compromised the picture as a whole.
Gail really wound up more running interference between me and Hemdale and Orion, who were, you know, much cheaper than we were.
I was an advocate not only for Jim, but for the movie.
We did the first Terminator for I think, you know, the cost of your motorhome on the second film. Or your oatmeal budget.
Exactly.
Right before we started shooting, Linda Hamilton broke her ankle.
Before the first Terminator, I broke an ankle and tore ligaments, and that never really has been it's never really been strong since then.
And we were concerned and that she'd be able to actually carry out the performance that was essential. She had to run throughout the movie, and it was mostly Linda, by the way, on a broken ankle that had to be wrapped every day, and we had to completely shift the shooting schedule so that most of the running scenes took place later on. And that always throws a production into disarray when you change the schedule as much as we had to.
You know, we shot downtown LA, the worst parts of LA, at night, during the summer. So it was hot, it was humid, it was dirty, smelly, all those alleys and stuff. It was nasty. But it worked for the movie.
The underground nightclub, disco, we called it tech noir because we felt that if we were going to get any good reviews at all, it might be good to spark critics' interest in the kind of filmmaking that we were doing, that it was, as opposed to film noir, tech noir, the dark side of technology. And that's what we called the nightclub in the film. And we shot it downtown in a place that had been a restaurant. And the great thing about it was that it seemed so realistic that people tried to pay to get in the night after we wrapped. We were so desperate for cash at that point, we almost took their money. But Better Sense got a hold of us, and we declined the paying patrons.
Yeah. You remember how we did the punch through the window with that steel fist? And we couldn't, and the whole rig was too heavy to move.
Right.
So instead of moving the car is sitting still, and we moved the brick wall behind the car.
That's right. Yeah, we moved the brick wall,
You were strapped into this thing with like a fake arm, and your real arm was behind you.
Yeah, the arm was behind, and then the machine arm was right next to me, and so it was shooting from the side, and made it look like it's my arm and all this. It was terrific stuff, but I just remember talking about that alley that we shot those scenes in. I've never done more running than that night. Remember how many times we had to run with the camera really low, running down that alley with these hideous leather boots on, these heavy leather boots on, and then jump up that car and all this. So the stunts were really severe, and it was really tough, especially with all this stuff on it, with the leather jacket and all that, and then the squirts going off and the explosions and all this stuff. But again, I think that the more you as an actor participate in the stunts, the better it's going to work out then, because the more believable it is.
I'll tell you, the most physical thing that I saw happen on that movie was me entering the Earth, which was me coming through time. And they shot that with a stunt guy, and they put two ladders up about 5 or 6 feet, and they laid a 2x4 across the top, and he laid on top of it, and they put a camera down low, and he basically just scooched off the ladder and landed, shoulder, hip, knees. And from 5 feet up, if you think about cement, it does not give. We were behind the camera cars, hooked up to those camera cars, and looking back on it, man, we were driving fast. Those camera cars were pulling us fast, and we were sliding around corners and stuff. And I remember once driving and I'm screaming at Linda, and we're ripping around corners, and you know, attention. I mean, I have a hold of the wheel, and I'm screaming, Terminator, you know, whatever, and we're ripping, and he's rolling film, and I'm right in the middle of my speech, and I pull back, and I pull the steering wheel right off the steering stem, you know, and I'm like, here you drive, you know. We had a lot of fun doing it.
Arnold was tremendous to work with because you can't get Arnold down. Arnold is always up. And regardless of how difficult a day we were having, Arnold would play a practical joke or say something that would make us all laugh uproariously. And that keeps the morale on the set really high.
He had a great work ethic. He's 100% committed, dedicated, disciplined to achieving the best possible result.
He believed completely and unwaveringly in this project.
Now the thing is, Arnold wasn't available to us until I think 2 weeks into the shoot. And we really had no idea if we had a film. I mean, we were doing our jobs and it was looking okay, but it didn't have this kind of sense of energy or chemistry. Arnold walked in the first night and it was in the kind of post-burn makeup where his eyebrows were gone and his hairline was back and he had this kind of punked out haircut. And we slammed him in the police car and we started shooting and we got that Adam Greenberg lighting with that cold kind of cyan glow from below. And when we saw dailies the next day, we just went, oh baby, this is great. And I also noticed that within a few days of that, all of the kind of the circling vultures, all the nattering nabobs of negativity that were kind of, you know, circling the production all kind of backed off a step and let us work.
I get asked about Arnold all the time, of course. Arnold and I rarely, if ever, work together. Now I saw him around, he was doing his thing and I was doing my thing. We never worked together. We never did a scene together. That was the only time we were ever on frame together. I mean, we were always running away from him. If he had caught up with us and I was doing a scene with him, we would have had no movie, you know? By the time I got into the same frame as the Terminator, he was no longer Arnold Schwarzenegger. He was a special effect and he was Stan Winston's wizardry.
Jim wanted to see some other variations because he's also an artist who wants, you know, choices. He's a brilliant artist, but he wanted choices. And we went through some variations. Some artistic variations, some sculptures of different possibilities for the look of the endoskeleton, and we ended up going right back to the initial concept that Jim had in the painting. He did some sketches himself, and we started doing detail work, and actually Jim became probably the most important artist in my studio. And it was me constantly being able to go, Jim, I understand, but why don't you give me a little sketch here? And sort of milk out the sketches from Jim Cameron, go, okay, fine, we'll work on that. And then I could go over to the guy and say, we're done, we got it. Let's just, here's the body cavity, and here are the hips, and here's the shoulder. And by the time all was said and done, Jim had detailed in sketch every detail of the endoskeleton, and thank God for him. And then I ended up taking credit for it all, which I will continue to do.
When we initially met with Stan, we felt that it might not be possible to get away with as much during principal photography as we ultimately were able to capture on film at that time.
The concept of creating a full-size endo, I literally had to talk Jim into. He planned on most of all of the endoskeleton work being done in stop-motion animation.
Yeah, he was torn about how much should be done which way. He wanted it to look as real as he could, and so he always struggled with how he was going to get what he wanted, given the time and money we had on this project. I think he originally probably thought it was going to be more in stop motion.
I said to Jim, I really think that we can create the endo full size and get a lot of performance out of the real thing, doing it with puppetry and animatronics. And Jim went for it, knowing also that there would be some things we couldn't do that he would have to rely on stop motion animation for.
And with Stan's ability to see the movie from beginning to end and to mind meld with Jim in terms of the storyboards for each sequence, we realized that we could actually do a lot during production, but we had to be able to know in advance what those sequences would entail.
I knew that we could get some walking and some movement by creating an upper torso puppet of the Terminator that would be carried on the shoulders of a puppeteer, which is one of the techniques we used. Shane Mahan was the Terminator puppeteer who carried the upper torso Terminator, affected his walk and his limp and his dragging leg, and everything that he did generated to that upper torso puppet. Then we added our animatronic techniques to head and eye movement, which was developed by Sonny Berman and Bob Williams. That was the upper torso puppet. We also built a full standing endoskeleton that Jim could shoot from head to toe, and the shots where he's blown in half and he's being dragged along. Again, the upper torso puppet, but being pulled along from underneath the floor. As far as the rigs we had mechanical insert arms. We developed our first robotic hands, which we would use as inserts and grab the grating and pull them forward. And we also had our exploding dummy endo. It was a urethane endoskeleton that we used to actually blow up. And the reason we had to make it out of urethane and we chromed that urethane was from a safety factor. We didn't want metal pieces, killing all of the people on the set when we blew up this robot. We had insert feet that you would see walking up the stairs. And we made a huge oversized endo eye area that we used for close-ups for the eye operation, and also allowed us to show the eye irising using actually a camera lens for that piece. So those were all the various pieces that we used for the endo. I also knew that ultimately, to really sell that there was a robot under there, we would have to duplicate Arnold as a puppet. A couple of sculptures were actually done. We used one of them in the truck at the end when he was driving. The interesting thing is that as good as the heads turned out, the makeup turned out actually better than we thought it would. And I think allowed Jim some more freedom as a filmmaker to shoot, for Arnold to be able to act more, and then a couple of close-up shots just to sell the depth inside that skull. And it works as a storytelling device.
We were lucky that we had both trained under Roger Corman, and Roger taught us some very important lessons. And one of those was that oftentimes films are made in post-production. And we headed into filming knowing that we wouldn't know all the things that were missing until we'd had an opportunity to cut the film together. And we set aside money for that photography. We were doubly blessed in that Lindsley Parsons, who was the head of the LA branch of Film Finances, a completion bond company, believed in us as well. And when there was a lot of pressure on us to take that money out, because of course no one plans on not getting all the shots that are essential in production, no one has the luxury of having additional photography later on, he believed that was the smartest way to approach this film. And he supported us every step of the way.
It was a finite amount of money that we had to make this picture. When Jim needed additional shots in post-production, inserts or whatever, he either went out and shot them, or he hired a very inexpensive DP, or let's say the most DP he could afford for the money out of his own wallet.
It was the income coming in as director going back out, into the shooting.
And they would go and have a little guerrilla ragtag team of filmmakers and go shoot the shots, I think he got Arnold to pitch in, and I mean, everybody was committed to making this picture work.
We did everything you can imagine in terms of guerrilla filmmaking to pull the movie off. There was one point where we wanted to see that the Terminator was outside Sarah and Ginger's apartment, and we didn't have that shot. So we went up to the house where I lived, and we spray painted the doors black to match the color of the sliding glass door in their apartment. And we didn't have the shoes anymore, so we spray painted the shoes just to get that one shot.
In the last scene of the picture, when Reese is zipped up into a body bag, that body bag that Reese is zipped up in was actually Jim Cameron's suit bag. It was a vinyl suit bag that I think he had in his car. He just pulled it out and presto, he had a body bag.
And they just laid the suit bag over the top of me and opened it up and zipped it up. And it was shot in Griffith Park, and I was lying on top of a car with a suit bag lying on top of me with the zipper. So that was a little bit of guerrilla filmmaking. I'm sure we didn't have permits that night.
At the end of the shoot, we had to go back and do some insert shots. and he wanted a close-up at the end when the Terminator is crushed in the press and the last bit of the eye falls off and it dies and there's a little bit of haze and smoke. None of that had been created before we shot it. We put together on the spot while we were there with Jim's direction, with his art direction and his background of putting this stuff together, built a press out of foam core, the two halves, the top and the bottom, out of foam core, sprayed them silver. We took and fabricated a little eye section of the Terminator, the thing that you see falling off, out of foam core and tin foil, and did it there on the spot with tin foil, and then had that on part of a little tin foil headpiece, and took one of the eyes, put a light bulb in it, had that behind the tin foil, took these two foam core set pieces, pushed them down, the little tin foil thing popped off, the little a little eye is sitting there, and we just sort of dialed it down and let it go away, and the little smoke is wafting through the shot, and the smoke is literally the smoke from a cigarette. There was someone off stage going, and we shot that shot, and it's in the film, and it works. And with all of this stuff that costs hundreds of thousands of dollars, and the sculptures that take forever, here's this close-up image, this final close-up image that is basically foam core and tin foil and cigarette smoke, and it's the last image of the Terminator in the movie.
I think everybody put their heart and soul into this picture, and it shows, because the passion definitely shows up on the screen. Gail's passion, Jim's passion, Arnold's passion, I mean, the actors were all committed.
And I think that makes a difference. I think it shows in the film.
We were naive enough at that point not to realize it was an impossible dream. And I think because of that naivete, we were able to actually pull it off. So in the desert, we needed to film the establishing shot. Linda wasn't available, so we got my secretary assistant, Polly Apostoloff, my mother's dog. We actually were able to get the Jeep. And we went out there with Gene Warren, Jim, myself.
And then my son, Chris, came out to help us with the stands and put his things.
And I was basically there just to muscle the gear.
We did it on a Sunday where...
We literally went out to a location.
It was out in the middle of nowhere.
We were setting up all day for the right light. Not one car had driven by the entire time we were setting up.
We're 5 minutes away from shooting.
And we literally had the tripod just a few feet into the pavement.
I have Polly drive the Jeep on out and drive away.
And just as we're about to roll,
a little dot of a car starts to show up, and Jim says, wouldn't you know, it's probably a cop.
A cop car pulls up. And we were completely unprepared.
We didn't have a permit or anything.
We weren't supposed to be there.
And he pulls up, and what are you folks doing? And
excuse me, you're gonna have to move your equipment off the road, and by the way, where's your film permit?
My dad turns around and says to him, well, my son, it's his film school project.
Well, we were helping my son do a film.
A UCLA student film, and we just needed one shot, and then we would get out of there.
And I just stood in the background, smiled, gave him a little, you know.
And the highway patrolman thought, well, a little thing like this, and helping out your son do a film, it's fine, he understood film school and all that.
The policeman was very cooperative and said, okay, he would go hold traffic.
And he changed his whole attitude and says, well, if that's the case, then that's fine. You know, you are in the middle of the road.
But we should have to take this off the highway because it was dangerous and, you know, and don't obstruct the highway.
Which, of course, was not a problem because he was the only car that drove by there the entire day.
Meanwhile, me, I'm about to pee in my pants because I'm like, they're blaming it on me.
So we moved it over 3 feet and he left and we shot it and went home.
And that was actually the last shot of the film.
We started off with the hunter killer sequence first, future war sequence. We first built a 3-foot platform which all the miniatures would be shot on. And in the background were cutouts of ruined cities, and in the foreground you had ruined buildings and skulls and things of that nature.
we forced the perspective a lot, because to have the distance that appeared there, they have to have far larger stages and distance, so that the backgrounds were generally a smaller scale with cutouts, and usually foam core or cardboard in some cases, just to make the silhouettes for the backlight. The skulls that the HK rolls over were, you know, about this big. And also in some of those shots, we had a larger scale in the foreground, like shooting across a skull that was right in the foreground, something I couldn't do with one of these little ones and still hold a depth of field.
Gene is a master of forced perspective photography, and with a full-size human skull in the foreground and little skulls no further than a foot away, it gives it the illusion like there's a ton of them, first of all, but it's real skulls.
One of the problems with that is that you're in on many of those close shots were on wide lenses. Did a lot of handheld work where I'd be in within 4, 5, 6 inches away from the models, shooting high speed at generally, I mean, anywhere from 80 to 120 frames a second. The sets were very hot. We had to have lights really pounding in there in order to maintain focus and depth of field so that it didn't appear to be miniatures. You had to have a real high light level.
When it came to building these hunter-killer tanks, we literally built them from the ground up, meaning that once the treads were finished, then we'd go in and shoot those scenes, and then a portion of the body, we'd shoot those scenes, and then eventually the top section, and then the head was radio controlled. It had to be built in stages, because there wasn't any time, and we had to start shooting right away because of a lot of scenes that required opticals, the lasers.
Jim had a, you know, vision of what he wanted the laser to look like, and not just a single line that glowed. He wanted them to have a lot of depth, complexity. He had a color that he was really working for. An awful lot had to go through an obstacle to put the lasers on. Most of the searchlights, though, were actually accomplished on set within the smoky environment we had.
Smoking up the stage was to hide basically the cutouts in the back, that because the set was forced perspective. The entire depth of the set was approximately maybe 16, 18 feet. So we had to give it distance, and the way to do that is to create this atmospheric haze over the entire set to give it scale.
We used a lot of the cracker smoke, but also we were still occasionally using, when we needed it thicker, gum olibanum, which is a bee smoker thing that you actually burn charcoal.
And if you're Catholic, you know what the smell smells like. We'd be sucking in this smoke every single day, and it was as hot as hell out there in Burbank during the summer. The grenade that goes underneath the tank treads was just a 2-inch little set piece, and to try and get it to go directly underneath the treads was a pain in the ass. I think we got it on the 26th take.
He wanted the explosions to have a lot of energy and punch.
The nucleus of an explosion is always usually a bright orangish look to it. What I added to this charge were two AG1 General Electric flash bulbs, and to create that orangey effect was a orange amber gel over the flash bulbs. I would have the flash bulbs go off first and then the explosion. And what I would do to create a fiery effect was to use, of all things, walnut dust. And walnut dust, once it's atomized, will create a fireball. The Flying HK wasn't also completely built. We built only one, and it was very rough at that. The detail was really on the undercarriage of it. So they had to make cutouts of like the pods on the side and put them on because they needed a shot right away with the Flying HK. So we got away with a couple of shots like that. One of the problems that I remember having was how to make it fly and not go back and forth kind of a thing as you're pulling it. So it was all on cables, it was all on piano wire that held it up, and we had wires that went off for the lights that are on the side of it also. We did a lot of scenes where halfway through the motor would slow down and then the whole thing would be jerking back and forth. We got through it. It turned out okay.
Most composites where principals, actors are in front of either miniatures or some type of effect are done with either front screen projection or rear screen, and both are employed in this.
Jim was a big advocate of rear screen also, so a lot of those scenes were accomplished first. Gene planned it out so that that we knew exactly what he needed for the processing shots or the opticals that needed to go into it. Gene is a master at that sort of thing.
The tanker truck a sequence that blows up at the end was all done full miniature on a complete miniature set. There were no composites on that.
Jim Cameron originally wanted to blow this, a full-size tanker truck, up, but he couldn't because where he was shooting it in downtown Los Angeles was in front of the police armory, meaning that they had all the guns and the ammunition and the police helicopters up on the roof of this building. So what Gene had to do was create the entire atmosphere in miniature, 1/6 scale, in the front parking lot of Fantasy 2 in Burbank, and then blow up a miniature tanker truck.
The end of the explosion had to match what had already been shot 10 days before in principle, because since principle was shot first, you had the wreckage of the truck on fire and burning, and so we had to blow it up and have it end up looking like the wreckage.
I have always had the philosophy of chain reaction, stretching out the scene. So when Michael Biehn puts in the pipe bomb at the back end of the tanker truck, I envisioned the explosion happening at the back end of the tanker truck, rushing towards the cab of the truck, instead of one giant explosion. There was a total of 42 separate explosions on the tanker truck. It created a terrific look. The first time we tried this, the gas was loaded, the bombs were loaded, the wiring was all done, the cameras are ready. We've got three cameras on it, and we're shooting 120 frames per second. Lights were ready, everything is ready. And what happened was the cable that was attached to the front axle pulled it so hard that it just ripped it out from underneath the cab. And there are the wheels, and I'd already started setting off the explosion, so I had to set it off the rest of the way.
Well, best laid plans, you know, you, you do everything you can to make something work right.
So I set off the rest of the charges. We put it out, and there was a collective groan amongst everybody on the set. So we then right away started working on another model, and 2 days later, we got the shot. And to this day, there's a lot of people that still think that it's not a model that's only 1.5 feet high and 8 feet long.
We were submitted quite a few samples for possible composers for the film. And needless to say, when you come to music, that's where you literally have no money left.
They had a low budget action picture. That's what it was billed as. So I was like, oh, okay. You know, it wasn't anything I was super excited about. And we had that sit down talk where the filmmaker tells you sometimes before he shows you his film what he feels the film is about and what elements are in it. And I'd been through a lot of those talks, you know, the philosophy and the depth of it and the dream of the filmmaker. And then in many cases they show you the picture and you're sitting there going, where is that movie? Where's the movie they were talking about? You know, it's like, is it there? I don't see it. Oh, there's a little, I understand what he was talking about. There's a little, you know, they're talking about some big concept and there's this one little thing that relates to it, you know. So I sat down, and I must say, I wasn't cynical, but I always was sort of, when, you know, Jim had a lot of big feelings about the film and passion for it, so when he spoke about it, it was very impressive, and I'm sort of, part of my brain's going, well, let's see, you know, and I'm watching the film, and, you know, 10 minutes in, I'm going, it's here. Wow, it's really here. What he's talking about is on the screen, you know, the depth of it and the mood and the energy of it and the intensity of it. And so I'm sitting going, I gotta do this, gotta do this. So we're watching the film and it's mattering more and more to me, and I'm really, you know, sort of feeling vulnerable, like, okay, now, you know, instead of being like, well, let's see, I'm going, oh, please, please, I hope you're gonna hire me for this movie. And there was a point, I guess, where he blows up and I go, if he gets up one more time, I'm leaving. I said it, I thought I was thinking it, and I said it out loud in the room, and then I'm sitting there thinking, I can't believe it. I can't believe I said that. I just lost the job. I just got very quiet and watched the rest of the film and figured, okay, well, that's it.
Brad really got the idea that this needed to have a percussive driving beat to go with the action of the film.
It was the idea of this mechanical man, in a sense, and his heartbeat.
He was great because he had no time, he had no money, and we were adding shots all the time in post-production as we'd get them in, and it didn't faze him a bit.
He did the whole score in his garage,
It was a cool garage. I mean, he had a lot of good gear.
I had all these individual keyboards, and they had to be played individually. It was all live. Every note is live performed, with the exception of this. I had an Oberheim situation where I could put a little drum machine and a little those things were chained together, but it was their technology. It didn't interface with anything else. So if my Prophet 10 was going boom, 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 and the other thing was going I had to literally sit there live and change the tempo and try to get them to match. Part of the nature of the score is me trying to get control of the machines. While the machines are trying to get control of the people in the movie, I'm sitting here desperately trying to get control of these machines.
This way.
When they finally get together in the police station, and he's now someone who had been like stalking her, they're now, you know, he's taking her and they're partners in a sense. I thought, great, and they're escaping. Da-da-dum, dum-dum-dum, you know, they're running out of the police station. And Jim heard that and he said, no way. He said, that's going to open up a part of the brain of the audience that's sort of emotional and maybe a little intellectual, like, ah, the theme, they're together, you know, it taps a little part of their, he said, I don't want to distract their synapses. I just want them like this, you know, I just want them to go, they're going to go, you know, the music is the same. We just took the theme out, but underneath there was the running of it, you know, and the theme, I just thought, gave it this heroic moment. And he just said, no. And I think that in that awareness, he knew exactly why he didn't want the theme there. I hadn't worked with a director that had that level, that was dealing quite on that level.
I don't think the studio knew what they had. I know that they didn't know what they had.
If they did, they would have thrown a lot more money at it, and they probably wouldn't have let Jim direct it.
Initially, the studio perceived it as a down and dirty action exploitation film.
Like a Charles Bronson film, 1 week in and out.
After, let's say, the negative word of mouth,
I made the statement that as a science fiction film, we should sell it on its own merits because that's a very particular audience. He said, this is not a science fiction film. I was dumbfounded. I said, yeah, it is. He said, no, it's not. I said, it's a science fiction film. He said, you can't sell this as a science fiction film. Star Wars is science fiction. If you promise that, people are going to feel betrayed. If they go into a theater and you're telling them it's science fiction and it's this. I said, well, it does involve time travel and robots, two of the biggest mainstays of science fiction. All science fiction films aren't necessarily about space travel. He didn't get it.
When we began to believe we had something, was the very first screening, and our very first advocate was once again Lindsley Parsons from Film Finances, who came to us and said, this is a really good movie. You guys have put something on screen here that is not only a good action movie, but it's an important action movie. There's no way when you're making your first film that you have any objectivity at all about what you've captured.
You never really know how a movie's going to do until it gets in front of an audience. You never know how it's going to do.
And then we showed the film to the actors' agents. And both Ed LaMotta, who represented Michael Biehn.
And he was a person who saw that movie and said, we have to get this screened in town and get a buzz going on it.
He saw the movie and he got it, as did Lou Pitt, who represented Arnold Schwarzenegger. They got it, and they are the ones who insisted that Orion screen the film for critics. And we started getting the response that Jim and I realized that we had touched a nerve, that the film was not being perceived as just a down and dirty exploitation film, but a film that actually had something to say that connected not only with audiences, but with critics as well.
When the movie came out, I remember the first thing that happened was that they said, oh my God, we have as many women seeing the movie as men.
Right.
So we should change our ad campaign. And I said, I told you guys,
exactly,
this is what's gonna happen.
But then of course, they'd already spent all their ad money and they didn't spend any more ad money. So
exactly, they were like frantically running around and coming up with ways of letting the women know that it is a movie that they can also enjoy.
It was impossible to anticipate that the film would get the kind of almost universal positive reviews that we got, and that the film would open up and maintain the same box office week in and week out for a number of weeks.
It's just that sometimes things click with the audience and you produce something or you create a character that really hits home.
I'll be back.
one of the shocks of the film was that people related to the Terminator so much. And I think it's because there's an awful lot of pent-up rage and frustration, and a lot of that frustration is because we're, you know, in a crowded urban society and job pressures and things like that, and people don't get to act out these fantasies. And we live in an age of weapons where you can't just punch somebody without them pulling out a gun and shooting you. You can't yell at somebody on the freeway without them, you know, shooting you with an AK-47. So there's a lot of pent-up rage and hostility, and I think the Terminator was a release for that. I think that we're also reacting psychologically to this kind of dehumanization. Or programming ourselves to interact with strangers. And I think that that's why the kind of the android myth has become so popular in recent years and in films, because it sort of answers that question. Or if nothing else, it says, we have become so dehumanized that a machine could pass for human easily in our society.
But anybody who thinks that Terminator is a cynical movie didn't get it. Far from it. It's a film that says the least among us is probably the most important person in the world.
The suggestion is that whether you're male or female, but specifically if you're female, you'll have capacities that others around you may not recognize and you may not even recognize in yourself. But if put to the test, they will emerge.
It wasn't just shoot them up, blow them up, but you know, there was a story, a love story that was a lot larger than life, and I think it drew a lot of people to us that ordinarily wouldn't have liked the picture.
Part of it was timing, part of it was that we really did deliver a good film, and a film that at the time became part of the whole zeitgeist of America in 1984.
I was fairly new to that process, so it was exciting to me, and I was just totally focused on the whole process. You know, I thought, I need to do a film myself. As director, I need to create this. I can't pay somebody to do it. I don't have any money. So I'll do it myself. I'll do everything myself. Necessity's a mother, as they say.
I mean, he wants to do basically everything because he has such a clear vision of what he wants to see.
He was very, very precise in what he wanted and meticulous. And he wanted it his way. He wanted to get what he wanted. He wanted his vision up there.
And he really does know what he wants. He's not just throwing a baby director fit. It's because he knows how it should be. And I would say about 98% of the time, he's completely right.
It was no accident. He really understood, I think, frame by frame in that picture, and when I look at it now, I really can see how much he was putting in and how much Jim really knew what he was doing.
He's a taskmaster, but it was all for something.
It's a good challenge, and he brings your game up.
I wouldn't call myself a workaholic, but when I'm on the set, it's 100% focus, and when I'm making a film, it's 100% focus. So I'm a kind of, you know, workaholic for a period of time.
He will be the first guy on the set, the last one to leave. He will be standing when everybody else has passed out.
You see him ending up running with the smoke machine and creating smoke in front of the camera, and then putting on blood and trying to do your makeup, although the makeup and special effects department has already done the job, but he then has to improve on it somehow.
Jim's like explaining the blue screen camera to the guys and what they should be doing. I mean, these guys are in special effects all their lives, and Jim's saying, oh, no, you can't. Oh, you having trouble? Oh, this is how you fix that.
He understood. I mean, you could talk about things, how to do them, what you wanted to do.
Jim understands that the technology is there to serve him.
He did that with everybody. Camera, sound, I mean, he knows everybody's job better than they do. And he's better at it than they are. And I think sometimes he gets frustrated because of that.
He's a control freak, basically.
It's just his style.
I've always said that he can't act, as far as I know. So he's always gonna need us.
And the great thing about Jim is that he is not only great at screenwriting, but he's an artist as well.
It was the art of storytelling, and that's the brilliance of Jim Cameron. That's the brilliance of Terminator 1. I've done a lot of things over the years that are better technically than Terminator. Not a lot of stories that were better than Terminator.
If you want to know everything you need to know about Jim Cameron's films, go look at Terminator 1, because it's all there. All the essentials are there, and everything that he has continued to grow into and to expand. All the roots of it are right there.
It was the vision of Jim Cameron that everybody really sunk their teeth into in the way of wanting to make something good out of it. Plus, we were having fun and there were challenges.
I'm just so happy to have been part of it.
We all did our jobs, we did well. It really shows the power of good acting and good storytelling. I think that that's the best accomplishment that we collectively came to on that film.